honestly, sometimes they just don't measure it.
They just do their spin in their yellow top tubes, and then they took 12 mLs of whole blood and brought it down to 3 cc's of PRP, so it must be PRP when it might not be. Platelet-rich plasma. So this is something that is hotly debated in the orthobiologic community, because technically platelet-rich plasma, per the definition, which I don't remember the year, I think it was the 70s when the term platelet-rich plasma came in, and it was from the hematologists, and they were basically just saying platelets above baseline. And now that we're using platelet-rich plasma clinically, there's a difference between 1.1x platelet-rich plasma and 4x and 10x and 40x. And so one of the big criticisms with a lot of papers, specifically the papers that have come out in JAMA on platelet-rich plasma doesn't work, is that they didn't use what other research has shown to be minimal effective doses for platelet-rich plasma. So it'd be like saying, all right, we have studies showing that 500 milligrams Keflex is effective when you do it 4 times a day for cellulitis, but we're gonna do a study to see if Keflex 100 milligrams once a day for 2 days works. Right. Oh, Keflex doesn't work for cellulitis. Well, no, it can, it's just not the right dose. And so it's really important that when we're talking about platelet-rich plasma, when we're reading research on platelet-rich plasma, that we're actually looking at the dosing. And sometimes they won't give that in some of the older papers, and you'll have to like look at supplementary data online, or you'll have to reach out to the researchers and things like that to get that data. And honestly, sometimes they just don't measure it. They just do their spin in their yellow top tubes, and then they took 12 mLs of whole blood and brought it down to 3 cc's of PRP, so it must be PRP when it might not be. And so that's really, really important.